our meeting on May 23rd, 2023 for the town of Frederick. Megan, will you take the roll, please?
Trustee Lamach?
Here.
Trustee Brown?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Here.
Mayor Kreitz?
Here.
Trustee Mahan?
Here.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Here. Sorry about that.
Trustee Padilla?
All right, we have a full board tonight. Thank you. Let's stand and join each other for the Pledge of Allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Nice job on that close-up, Kyle. You got in on that flag.
That's nice. Well done. All right, I do not believe we have any changes to our agenda tonight. Is that the case?
That's correct.
Okay, and no special presentations, so we will move into public comment. Thank you. This portion of our agenda is provided to allow members of our audience to provide comments to the town board. Please sign in and I will call you. Let's see. I have Cheryl Garcia this evening.
And my husband. Well, that was quick. I didn't even get a chance to get nervous. Okay, and Cheryl has something written out for me to recite for her. She says, I'm back. We are Gil and Cheryl Garcia, 4805 Kingbird Drive in Erie Valley. Tonight, I have a few thoughts that I would like to speak on. One, when will the town start mosquito spraying? With all these pop-up lakes around town, I anticipate a rise in mosquitoes and invasion of the body snatchers. I would like to know when it starts and what nights they will be spraying. I can let my peeps, my neighbors, and my posse know when to stay inside. Okay. Two, I would like to ask the town to consider adding an all-abilities playground, inclusive for all kids to play. Per ADA Title II, the general requirement states, Title II of the ADA requires state, local governments to give people with disabilities an equal opportunity to benefit from all of their programs, services, and activities. State/local governments can't deny people with disabilities the chance to participate or make them participate in different programs that are available to others. By having a playground that's open, accessible to all kids, it gives them the opportunity to be included. I would like to be part of the planning. It will keep me off the streets and out of the pokey. Gil doesn't have any bail money left. Regarding National Night Out, August 2nd, for my hood, which is Eagle Valley and Raspberry Hill, I would like to request a grant of $500 to help provide more activities for this event. It would cover a bouncy house, some lawn games, potato sacks for the sack races between fire and police. They are on notice, I'm assuming. Toyota has covered our DJ in the past. King Supers and Safeway donates $25 each. Chick-fil-A donates fresh baked cookies. My HOA does not contribute to this event. And so. And that's all she has.
Very helpful. Thank you. I like that curtsy. That's very nice. Thank you. Okay, I do see, I'll go out of character and ask Kobe, would you join us, please, and share an update on 1 and 2? So mosquito spraying, when and where, please.
Mayor and trustees, for mosquito spraying, that's contracted through Public Works, but I did just talk to them a couple weeks ago and they're using the same contractor that they used last year. And I believe all the information they have for spraying times and that kind of stuff is available on our town's website. I don't know the URL off the top of my head. It's slightly different than years past. It's not just fogging neighborhood to neighborhood. They're actually putting out a number of traps, a number of other larval applications, so they can reduce the frequency of some of those fogging apps, so they're not quite so harmful to environment and our residents. That won't at all reduce the effectiveness of those applications. It's just doing it a little bit smarter.
And Mayor and Colby, if I could, on our website under Public Works, where you go under the mosquito link, you can actually opt out if you don't want a certain area sprayed. So when you go onto the website, it's with our third-party contractor called VDI. They do a number of other communities within this area as well as the Denver metro area. You put in your name and address and the concerns, and they will not spray in that area.
What was the second question?
Well, first, thank you for sharing that. I know that you addressed this at Mayor TNT time last week, so I knew you would know the answer. So thank you. In that regard, too, can we talk about maybe eventually when we have the Town of Frederick app up and running, can that be a communication tool as well? Can we make sure that we notify, you know, neighborhoods of when we're spraying, and can they opt in and out from the app as well? That would be helpful. Thank you. And then the second one is the All Abilities Playground. I know you're working on park master plans. Will you share an update on that, please?
Yeah, so I would just say as a general rule, as we're developing these park master plans, we're focusing more on what's called universal accessibility. It's not meeting the bare minimum of the Americans with Disabilities Act. It's going above and beyond that and building things that are for folks with, you know, developmental disabilities that have things that may not fall under those purview of the ADA. As far as the Community Parks Master Plan, one of the things that I would imagine will end up being at Centennial or FRA will be at Inclusive Playground. And so when we get to that point, we will absolutely be taking public input on all of it, but I would love to reach out to Cheryl and get her individual input, especially at post-commission meetings or stuff like that when we are actually developing the design of that playground itself. That's an easy one.
I knew you'd be excited and uh-huh. You're smiling when she asked that, so that's nice. Thank you. Okay, great. Really appreciate that, Kobe. Thank you. Third item from the Garcias is a $500 donation to National Night Out. Typically, we do have a donation request process, but you are all welcome to consider that now, or you're welcome to ask that we follow that donation process as well. It's up to you.
I can come back.
Okay.
Anytime.
Is that your preference, or would you all like to consider this item now? Okay. I will ask that we follow the process. And it sounds like, Megan, will you be able to connect the Garcias with the application process itself?
I believe I've already sent the application,
okay.
But I'm happy to send it again.
Okay. All right. That would be nice. Thank you. And that brings up a great point. You know, year after year, National Night Out in August is something that the police department certainly benefits from opportunities to engage with the community. The town itself has provided the space and has provided some communication about it. But typically, the town of Frederick has not been as hands-on for that event as it's a police-related function. Last year, though, you all asked that the town get more involved in National Night Out, including yourselves. So perhaps we can spend a few minutes in the next few weeks to decide, you know, are you all taking a tour of all the neighborhoods during National Night Out? Are there other ways that we can be supportive as a town and community to the Frederick Police Department and to National Night Out in general? So perhaps we could talk about that because we've not talked in detail.
What night is it, August 2nd?
August 2nd, I believe, yep.
Okay.
First Tuesday of August.
We did cancel Tuesday. That meeting.
Yes. Yes.
I was just concerned that it would conflict with the board meeting. Or...
We did have a meeting that night, but it has been canceled effectively. So.
Okay.
We'll see you all there at National Night Out. Okay.
Everyone up over there.
Yes. Okay. We appreciate that. Do come back, and we'd like to hear kind of where the donation request will go to, and we're excited to celebrate with you, so thank you.
Is that okay to sign up? Make what out to you? The funds? Oh, and you'll provide with receipts and everything. Yeah, so you'll know where the money went. Or my HOA, the not do anything for that.
Okay. Yeah, I appreciate that. And yes, that process that we have in an application will track kind of the funding pieces of it. So that would be great. And you do a really nice job. I know that there are stops that are just stops, which is great to say hi to our police family. But you always have activities and you're very entertaining. So thank you for doing that. I really appreciate that.
Are you what? Are you willing? To participate in the sack race?
Sure. Yes, that sounds great. As long as I don't have to karaoke, I'm there. That sounds fun. I'd be happy to. Okay, any other public comments? We'll move into our staff reports. Brian, please.
Yes, Mayor and members of the board. Tonight, I wanted to have Colby come up and just give you a quick update on the golf course.
Great, thank you.
Mayor, trustees, Brian asked me to give a quick update on the golf course, which turned into a whole page. So if I've gone too long, please give me the wrap it up. The restaurant's last official day with full service food was this past Sunday. The restaurant staff have been transitioned out. Grab-and-go items are being implemented this week. We'll obviously have some of your basic pop, hot dogs, chips, candy, but we're also partnering with Peak Refreshments, which is an Aurora-based company, to provide locally made cold sandwiches, wraps, and other similar items. It'll take a few weeks to figure out what kind of demand exists for those, so there may be spotty availability. We're not going to go buy 5,000 sandwiches and then throw 4,999 away. So there might be a couple weeks where we kind of figure out what the demand really is. The bar will continue to operate. We've updated all items needed with a liquor license to operate. We're in the process of hiring seasonal bartenders and beverage cart attendants to assist pro shop staff during peak times. There will be disruptions in that service for the next 2 weeks, just as we transition and train staff for the bar area. Going to be some new people, some folks that haven't bartended before. You'll probably see my shining face over the weekend if you're in there having a drink. For special events like tournaments, leagues, glow ball, we issued an RFP for interested vendors to cater those events. We received two responses, both from Frederick businesses. Due to just the number of events we have, those two vendors weren't actually able to cover every event. So we have a third vendor, also from Frederick, that's going to be willing to cater for our events. We'll continue to monitor golfer response to our offerings. And we may look at weekend food trucks or similar options as well. For right now, we're just focusing on those special events. Logistically, food trucks are a little hard. I know we've gotten that question from the public a few times. We don't have a lot of parking space, and so if we have people coming in that aren't playing golf and into the parking lot, we could have emergency access issues and things like that. So there'll be a little more logistics to figure out on that. We're also working through the logistics with groups who have rented the dining area space for private events. We'll make sure we're coordinating with all of those folks to get what they need to have their events. We're also revamping the rental opportunities for that area as a community gathering space here probably in early June. What we're trying to balance with that is the staffing requirement for an indoor facility. We obviously want to offer that service, but we need to be responsible with staff and fund resources as we revamp that program. Excuse me, my allergies, like everybody, are killing me. We hope to begin designs for improvements later this year to the floor plan of the existing clubhouse. And the goal of that will be to allow the bar and grab-and-go service to be completed by pro shop staff. That should reduce our overall summer staffing need considerably. As we're working on those designs, we'll kind of balance what that total cost is with what that staffing reduction might be, so we have a good return on our investment. Finally, just an update on the golf course itself. The parks and golf maintenance teams have been partnering on a number of improvements. The biggest one has been irrigation. You've probably heard a lot about that. That's just in an effort to try to get the course to the condition we want as soon as possible. Tim is continuing to offer excellent programming. We just had Family Day this past Saturday, which had dozens of families. I counted 60. I think Tim counted a few more than that. But the focus of our events is going to continue to be on growing the game of golf and offering memorable family experiences to our guests. That's the reason why we're there. Long-term plans for the golf course will be determined by the Community Parks Master Plan. While we have some idea of what those options might be, we need to obtain considerable public input, especially given the probable cost of those renovations, to really determine what the public wants to see. I've heard a lot lately, you know, quote, what are the town's plans for the golf course? And my answer to that has been that will be determined through a considerable, deliberate, and publicly engaged process throughout this year and into 2024. For the time being, we're going to continue to focus on improvements to our internal procedures, our equipment, our staff knowledge, and our customer service so that we have a solid foundation if we decide to go into any major renovation. And that was my speech.
Very well done. Questions?
It wasn't too long. I don't think it was too long. I think it was well informed.
I just wrote it 5 minutes ago, so.
Nice job. 5 minutes. I think, will you clarify on the grab and go, will it offer, you know, breakfast options? Is it just a lunch option?
We're going to start with lunch options, which also are obviously dinner options to start with. But the vendor that we're working with does have a number of breakfast options, a lot of breakfast burritos, things like that. We've got to work through getting a microwave and where to plug it in and some stuff like that, just the logistics of how to cook it. But yeah, there will be.
Okay, it's exciting. I think, you know, everything that you just shared, Kobe, have been very consistent questions from the community. So not necessarily requesting that's a press release by any means, but that might be phase two to the communication to the community on what the plan is for the golf course. I would appreciate some partnership with the communication department on what that looks like.
I'll do.
Very well done. I really appreciate that. I know that the last few weeks and months have not been easy, but it is for the greater good. And I really appreciate all the effort that you and the team have put into making the golf course what the golf course is supposed to be about. So, thank you.
You bet. Thank you.
Hey, Mayor, if I could, just one other item as an update. Last week, the board asked kind of a status on the Carriage Hills irrigation system.
Yes.
So, since last week, we have confirmed that the blow-off that we were concerned about not functioning is now functioning. So, that was an important part. So, that works. We've also got the new meter was delivered and is being installed. It's either installed yesterday or today. We've got our construction inspector on site as that work is being done. And then the piping that was the wrong type of piping has been replaced. So we've had to come to a compromise in that regard as far as there's not any purple pipe available, which designates it as a raw water line. But the piping was a short amount of stretch, so it's been marked and adequately designated as best as we can to make sure that it's functioning, and also a notice for whoever might be down in the meter pit looking to drink water that it's not a safe water source for drinking. But that's where we're at on that, so that should be wrapping up here very shortly within the next day or so.
Yeah, I love that. That's really great to hear. Thank you. Appreciate that update. I don't know, Brian, if you have anything you'd like to share on your admin report, please do.
No, just anything else. If there's any questions, we'll probably have some more information at our next meeting, just in regards to some economic development updates, just things that are continually moving. I know Frederick is obviously on the map, and with the announcement of the King Supers, there's a lot of interest and activity that's been generated with different properties in Frederick. Nothing really to report of specific, but just obviously more activity than before we had the King Supers announcement, which was anticipated and very exciting.
Yeah, that might be helpful if you don't mind kind of sharing between yourself and Ryan. I know, did you just return today already from ICSC?
Yeah.
Okay, so maybe just a quick recap on that when you all get in.
Absolutely.
Like hearing a recap from a supermarket conference. Hear all the dirt, all the tea. Okay, any questions for Brian? And Megan, we don't have a town clerk's report on the agenda tonight, but you're welcome to share anything if you have any updates on anything.
I do have a couple of updates for the board. I was actually just
sending the board an email. So just wanted to let you know that the hammerhead wood carving in Chris Park that replaced the alligator wood carving in Chris Park has seen considerable damage, which we all kind of anticipated would happen due to its location and how fun it is for our youth. It was evaluated last week by Public Works. I work with Assistant Public Works Director Ribble on evaluating the pieces each year, making sure they're safe. And then if we can repair them, we work with a local carver to repair them. That piece was basically falling apart. So it was removed from Chris Park. And so we'll be looking to replace it at the Chainsaws and Chuck Wagons event. But for right now, if you get questions, we just didn't want anyone to get hurt. So.
Megan. Nope. All right. Thank you. Thank you both for your updates. We'll move into our consent agenda. Our consent agenda items are considered to be routine and will be enacted by one motion and vote. There will be no separate discussion of consent agenda items unless a board member so requests, in which case you may remove that item from the consent agenda and consider it at the end of the consent agenda. Anyone like to remove one of two items or both items on the consent agenda item tonight? Not some direction on that consent agenda, please.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to request the consent agenda be approved as is.
Second.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Lamach?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you. We'll move right into action agenda item D, please.
Mayor Kreitz and members of the board, tonight you have the opportunity to appoint a new committee member to the Frederick Arts Commission. If the board recalls, trustees Brown and Padilla participated with a number of staff members and interviews for our various boards, commissions, and committees. And this appointment is the last appointment from those interviews that were conducted in April. The candidate, Annabelle Lewis, is here, and I'd like to invite her to come up and introduce herself to you.
Good evening. Hi, thank you for having me. My name is Annabelle Lewis. I live over in Moore Farms off Bella Rosa. I've been here about 2.5 years with my family, my son, my daughter-in-law, and two granddaughters. And recently, about a year ago, I retired after 25 years with the Boeing Company. So I found myself with nothing to do. and I saw this come up on my Facebook ad, and I thought, well, I love to travel. And when I travel, the first place I go is to a museum. So I think my love for art, even though I don't know that much about art, I think will help me in this job, in this position. Thank you. Yeah. Nice to meet you all.
That makes a full Frederick Arts Committee, yes?
Two more vacancies.
More vacancies.
Yes. But we have a quorum, so yeah, let's start meeting and working on our master plan.
Great.
Definitely more than I think there's been in a long time.
So. Yeah, that's really nice.
Awesome.
Great. Okay. If there's no questions, some direction on action item D, please.
Madam Mayor, I move to appoint Annabelle Lewis to the Frederick Arts Committee.
Second.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Trustee Lamach?
Yes.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Annabelle, for your service. We look forward to working with you. Yeah. My middle daughter, Isla, who is 10, loves art so much that she made her own shirt that she wore to school today, and it said, "Today is a great day to make some art." So that was adorable. And the puff paint wasn't dry by the time she left the house. So it was a little bit stressful, but still really cute. Okay, we have discussion agenda item E. Sarah.
Where did they go? Just tell me next slide.
Okay.
Hey, good evening, Mayor and Board of Trustees. I'm back to talk to you guys again about the Chapter 13 Division 2 update to the Municipal Code that I've been working on with Jason Myers. So what to talk about today, again, just a brief overview of the water dedication requirements that we brought to you guys in April as a first flush of this is what we want to change the water dedication requirements to. Information about our proposed enforcement for water allotment overages, the process for an annual fee in lieu allowance set, and then ending with feedback from the board. Okay, so again, what we talked about in April was switching from one CBT unit per lot, per single family equivalent, to a demand-based analysis. Again, the data that we're using for the analysis is based on our actual indoor use to set our indoor use for property types for residential, and some information provided by Westminster to set a baseline for our commercial users that will update over time as we have more of those users come online. Since our customer base is so small, we can't get to those numbers ourselves accurately, as well as setting hydro zone, low, medium, and high water demands, so we can calculate the irrigation demands for projects. So this will be a big switch from our current code, because currently the only properties that are allowed to do a demand analysis are those ones that are using raw water, which isn't very good for water conservation. So making that change will really promote that water conservation, having good projects come into town that are saving water. So one of the concerns that came up in the April work session was how do we treat properties who go over that allotment if they're given a reduced water amount compared to our current code. So currently the code credits 0.6 acre feet per CBT unit. So that's what we use for our base water allotment for any CBT unit. So typically most single family homes in town, they have 0.6 acre feet. They're probably not going to exceed that unless we have a crazy year and they use a lot of water, or if it's a very big home and a big lawn. Same for commercial development. It's the same credit per CBT unit. That number of CBT units is going to be different based on the tap size that serves that commercial development. So the proposal is to monitor properties' water usage annually, send out notices if they do exceed that annual allotment. Try to be a little proactive, give them a warning if, hey, you're getting close to that, you need to watch your water usage, and we'll be working with the billing department to set that up. And then it will have a requirement for that owner to provide water to the town in excess of their water allotment to make the town whole for their overages. It does allow for cash in lieu at the board's discretion. That was added to help the smaller people like residential homeowners who they can't just go out and buy CBT units on the open market. So that's what the proposal is for those particular types of properties. So the annual fee in lieu allocation, you guys might be familiar, our current code sets the cash in lieu limit to 30 units per year for both infill development and non-residential development. And the residential development is capped at 3 CBT units per lot. That's what equals the 1.8 acre feet listed there. And in our 10-year water supply plan, it identified annually setting that so that way we can stay within the number of units that we're purchasing a year. And we know that we have the water to supply those users who come and ask, instead of just assuming that we're meeting our plan and we're able to purchase annually that 30 units. So this gives the town more flexibility. One thing that staff will be coming back to talk to the board soon is setting up a water allocation policy, which will allow the board more control over what properties are eligible for a cash in lieu incentive or fee in lieu incentive. So this goes hand in hand with that future proposal that we're going to be bringing to you guys. The language in the code was switched to acre feet
because we're not always going to be using CBT water. So wanted to make that change now so it's set up for future water use in the other water rights in the future. And I would propose that we bring this around the time of the budget annually, but we'll be bringing one soon for the adoption after the code. So we'll have something in place after the new code is approved.
And just to throw it out there, part of the reason we adjusted the language to acre feet as opposed to CBT units is because, and part of why the cash in lieu or fee in lieu section's important is because as we move forward, you know, 10 years from now or so, and NISP is online and delivering water, it may very well be impossible for people to purchase a unit of NISP water because that's not going to be something that's available on the open market like CBT is. But making sure that people are making the town whole in if they use water overages and or in these instances where they have an infill development that's just not the same as going out on the open market for a larger subdivision as the case may be.
So that all said, I wanted to give you guys a couple of examples for how this would be applied. So this is just a small subdivision example of 47 single-family detached homes. There is a detention pond area, a couple open space park areas. So under our current code, 47 homes, they would require 47 CBT units. And that would cover any indoor demand, outdoor demand, and the shared spaces demands. Under the proposed code change, the indoor and outdoor use for the homes would be about 31.5 CBT units for all 47 lots. The footprint that I use for the home, as well as the grass and the drip and rock, I looked at some of the subdivisions in town that are kind of that R1 size and looked at the standard layout of those types of lots to give you an idea of in Frederick at this type of subdivision, the size of subdivision, this is the amount of water that they would be using. The open space and park demand, this one was a little harder to estimate. So those are really rough numbers just to give you an idea if it's a large grass area, some drip, some native seed, the demand for the irrigation would be about 4 CBT units. So that would bring the total for the project to 35.4 CBT units. So that is, as you can tell, less than the current requirement would be. So one thing that we would like some feedback from the board is your comfort with that, with the figures that staff has proposed. Are you okay with that much of a discrepancy if it meets the numbers? We're using pretty standard numbers to calculate that irrigation demand, but it is a small number. And I also wanted to give you an example of a commercial site. So this is a sample retail site with a couple units, a lot of turf, and a big parking lot. So again, breaking down for the indoor-outdoor use is about 2 CBT units required for a lot of that caliber. This one is harder to compare to our commercial lots in town because it's currently based on tap size. So we don't have a lot of comparable type businesses to compare. So again, we'd love to have some feedback from you guys given this update from the comments that we received from the April work session. If you have any comments, questions, concerns.
Questions, concerns? I like the order of that. Comments first.
Just kidding. I had a question. I can wait.
I think, well, I guess the comment is, I think the timing of this and then who it applies to is a really important question. I have no expertise to question the numbers, though. If you're basing it on other cities in the Northeast Colorado, that seems a pretty reasonable method to me. This is more of, you know, kind of thinking ahead on how it rolls out and communication to people developing and within Frederick.
So in terms of timing, once this is brought back in its actual ordinance form and it's assuming it's passed at that point, which I don't assume. That'd be up to you all to decide. Once it's published, it would take 30 days for that to become effective, and at that point is where it would kind of kick in. The board does have the alternative to set a date when it would come in to effect. Beyond then, you know, if you're wanting to say, if we bring this back next month and you're wanting to say we want this to be effective August 1, you can certainly do that. We can't shorten that time frame because that's a statutory time frame for its effectiveness. But depending on how you'd like that communicated, as far as generally speaking, the projects that are already in process, this wouldn't apply to. But, you know, it's possible that you could. Generally, this may be in their favor because there's far more of a strict demand analysis as opposed to just a general assumption of CBT per lot. But we could certainly do that, set a date when this becomes effective and communicate that with the community and the development community there by extension, and they can time their submittals appropriately. I don't know if that answers your question.
I had a question. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So I'm just seeing, I'm just thinking about how we're trying to envision how a few years down the road, when the developer's gone, an HOA or something's taking care of the parks, how is a new owner, when the house changes hands, supposed to know what the usage estimate or what, you know, what would put them over their limit? Is that going to be something that's forced into their title or something like that?
Yes. And one of the things we drafted into the ordinance and the language basically states that all persons and developments that are subject to the applicable ordinance shall be required to record an instrument providing notice that water usage for the property is limited based on the amount of water dedicated for the property, and that those limitations would be kind of accounted for and available through the engineering department. I'd hesitate to put a hard number into a property title because that, I don't know what the future holds, but certainly that's our intent, is to make sure that that would show up in the title search and history, so that people are aware that there are limitations to the amount of water that's available for the property.
Right. Because I was wondering, as I keep seeing stuff on like some Weld County lots where they're having budget taps and things like that. And I just wondered what tool they were using that an agent would know, you know, when they're searching a property for their client. But it sounds like something like that would work, right?
Yeah, given the alternative, Sarah and I talked about this at length, is how can we effectuate that notice in a reasonable fashion, because we don't currently know when property transactions. And so being involved in that process, we typically don't find out until well after the fact. So that was the kind of the best and only place that we have that we could think of where to place that requirement. So at least provide notice that it exists. You know, water limits is not something that's new. It exists. But to your point, I don't know that most people are aware that their water isn't just a, you know, open your taps and let it run however much you want.
Well, I guess I was just thinking, you know, thinking about this up front and doing the best we can will probably create less problems later. So anyway, absolutely. Just wanted to talk about that. Thanks.
In their backyard, they will be contacted by the town and they will owe the town money at some point.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, the likely scenario is that they'll just be putting in a garden or something that uses a lot more water than they anticipate. That's the, going back to the point of coordinating with utility billing, when we see that usage is probably outpacing the allotment, we'll let them know. Having worked on a similar ordinances in the past and other communities that I've worked with, usually it's just a matter of communicating and making people aware, and then they'll change their habits. every once in a while, you know, usually in the business sector where they've got a standard corporate procedure for doing XYZ with water and they don't understand Colorado is different than other places, it's a little bit more friction, but there's that backstop of, you know, you're allowed to use X amount of water and you go over that, we're going to expect you to either come to the table with more water or change what you're doing, or we're shutting you off. So that protects the town and everybody else from having to subsidize those uses.
And another thing that we're looking at with the water rights study is if budget-based billing is going to be an option for the town, that's setting a budget for properties, and that's how much water they're allotted per month. So if they go over that budget, then they'll see a high surcharge on that. And that's another indication that, hey, you need to cut back on your water. We don't currently have a high surcharge fee in our fee schedule.
How many homes could be eligible for a high surcharge fee right now and that we're not charging?
Very
approximately.
I would say there's probably a couple in every neighborhood. There's a couple people that have pools, a couple of people that have like a side lot that was attached to their lot. So they have a really big yard and they want to make it look really nice. So the number of residential homes is pretty limited. Where we would see more of that, I think, would be in some of the older commercial where they just put in a 5/8 inch tap. So they're overusing for what that tap would allow.
Yeah, I remember when we had it.
Typically, or in the past, Sarah, you and your team have kind of, maybe this isn't the correct percentage, but I think we've talked about like estimating 10% overage, for example. You know, would that be applied in this case as well, to where it would be a very conservative effort in making sure there's some cushion to not make it such a drastic change on an overage? Have you considered
cushion? So what's in the numbers currently is a 25% cushion. So that 20% goes to the Central County Water District surcharge, and then 5% goes towards any type of water loss from the master meter to the home. So that's how we've accounted for a cushion.
And I suppose just a couple comments, if you don't mind. I'm concerned. I see the why behind this conversation. I appreciate, you know, that we're trying to find, you know, we've heard for years that Frederick has very expensive water. And we're trying to make sure that, you know, the water that we're charging people for, they're actually using. So I really appreciate the efforts here. But I think we're a little bit backwards in sometimes when we develop subdivisions, we have developers who will tell our planning department, will tell the town of Frederick, you know, here's what my subdivision is planned to look like, and here's what the park and the open space and the green space and the entryway and all this will look like. I'm concerned that we're making it seem like the narrative needs to come from the development community versus coming from the town of Frederick, because we're incentivizing a whole bunch of rock, which I understand. In many cases, we want to conserve water and we don't want a bunch of grass that we're going to have to maintain and pay to maintain. But are we setting the tone for sharing with the development community that they are in control of what parks look like? Or is there another component to this that we need to be focusing on design standards for new subdivision parks and open space that considers this water usage as well?
Yes, Mayor Kreitz. So part of the Growing Water Smart workshop that staff went to, a lot of that is, well, it's focused on the connection between land use planning and water resources. So one of the big things that came out of that is an action plan for staff to update the design standards, the land use code, to address those specific concerns. We still have developers that are currently asking for water conservation projects. We definitely will not want to approve anything that's just rock, because that's not the intent. One thing that came out of that is out of the workshop that I thought was interesting was talking about Coloradoscape. So it's not xeriscape where people think of just rocks, it's Coloradoscape. So it's native plants that thrive in our area in Colorado. So that's what we would like to bring to the board. There's going to be a discussion item, I think, on the 13th in more detail about that and what we're wanting to change to address those specific concerns.
In the interim, our current land use requirements still apply, so there will still be the potential disharmony between the code requiring tree lawns and irrigated turf and all those things. So in the interim, as those changes are being worked through the land use code update and additional feedback being garnered, there will still be that requirement for those developers to run those things past the board, because ultimately our code is what it is at this moment. Once that changes, then all of these things become in harmony. But this is kind of one of those first steps to get us to that area, so that when those requests come before the board, it's not, we need you to approve this laundry list of issues. It's, this has already been handled by the code, so you're not going to see those issues. It's going to be those outlying disharmonies, as it were, narrowing the scope of what's still on the table to be determined.
Right. And then the criteria is really that foundation for that conversation.
Right. And in regards to the water demand, as far as what's considered low, medium, or high, we did add some language to make sure that that's determined by staff's analysis, but generally inconsistent with those three categories, or in consideration of those three categories. But that way it's not a developer coming and telling us what it is. It's us telling the developer, this is where we believe it belongs, and staff's empowered to make that decision for the best interest of the town.
You think that's memorialized in this plan, that staff will truly have that backbench?
Right. And so underneath where it talks about outdoor hydrozones and the gallons per square foot and all of those things, the asterisks on the hydrozone, it says, as determined by town staff analysis, generally consistent with the following, low, medium, high.
The cash in lieu policy under this, is it still in compliance or in line with what we wanted to do with cash in lieu earlier?
Trustee March, I believe so. The language was added into the municipal code to allow for commercial development and some ease of commercial development, having that option available. So it keeps that option available, but it lets the board set how many units annually instead of just the same number each year. And so you can increase that number if we purchase more water for commercial development, or lower that number if you have less water available for development.
And in that same vein, so it's got the three different categories. One would be the single family infill. So you might have a couple of lots here and there that haven't ever been developed. So that would be an alternative for them, rather than going out on the open market and buying water rights directly. The second one would be for one industrial lot, so kind of the same scenario, or commercial slash industrial. And then the third option, I think, is the, if it aligns with your strategic plan goals, which you could then dictate in that resolution on an annual basis of saying, we would like to see this and we're willing to put these resources to it. You've made that determination, and now you don't have to see it again and again and again throughout the year. You can set that parameter, and that whole section is discretionary. So the board may do that, and you may choose not to do that. You don't want to provide any cash in lieu opportunities. That's certainly within your discretion. It does not do what has been done in the past, which is carte blanche. Anybody and everybody who wants cash in lieu can try to force that through the process.
It's very specific. What my concern was, Jason. That was the reason we started addressing cash in lieu a couple of years ago, I think it was, is that it was the way we were doing it. We basically said, no, if you're going to develop in Frederick, you got to bring your water with you. And I still kind of like that policy personally myself, but I also know we have to be flexible in a lot of different ways. And that's the reason I asked that, is I would not want to see that policy just blanketly go away. I still want to see developers be responsible for bringing their water to us and us not have to supply the water. So just something that come across my brain. I remember a couple of years ago when this all came around. So.
So let me pull it up. I've got the ordinance, draft ordinance pulled up, but the section heading is dedications for infill or special circumstances. I haven't labeled these with numbers yet because they're subject to change based off the communications tonight, but it would be 70. Seven, top, bottom of 70, top of 71 is that section.
There it is, yeah.
That would provide flexibility to the board to say, you know, if similar to the arrangement that was made with the King Supers development, saying we would like to dedicate certain amounts of water for economic development purposes within these parameters, now staff has the authority to work within those parameters to make that happen. If you don't like option three, you don't have to provide anything, but it gives you that opportunity to, on an annual basis, make what those policy decisions will be.
We've talked about, you know, in the last year or so that some municipalities kind of have this philosophy for permits as well, right? You know, they have X number of residential permits per year, so many commercial, industrial, and this kind of falls in line with that same philosophy then. So if we were to adopt a policy like that, it would be in parallel, I would assume.
Some municipalities, like Woodland Park is an example, given their limitations, etc. You know, every municipality is a hair different, but they do have a total number of taps that they allow to be utilized in a given year. And if there's anything above and beyond that, you have to come before the city council at that point and make your case and whether or not they're willing to change the parameters on any given year. And it provides flexibility for small developments, 1, 2, 3 lots at a time to occur, but Woodland Park's topography and geography doesn't really lend itself to 900 unit housing developments.
Right.
And that would be prohibited under their code by that same philosophy in regards to the water that's available.
There's no, you know, in this, just since this is a discussion, there's no opportunity for any retroactive agreements. Or any community or any subdivisions who have already developed and have paid for one CBT unit per unit or per household, we're not. There's no language in here that would assist that conversation.
Not in this instance. There is the ongoing discussions when we talk about water conservation and efforts that there could be some future discussions as to if a community or a neighborhood or otherwise wants to come in and request some restrictions and what does that look like as far as if I'm willing to do a turf replacement program, etc. How do we go about that? So that's more on the water conservation side than the dedication piece.
And on a case-by-case basis, not as a subdivision as a whole, unless you're talking about a community park or something like that.
At this point, we haven't really drilled into what that'll look like at this stage, but you know, it's certainly the prerogative of the board to dictate what that could be.
Okay. Got yours answered?
Yeah.
Okay. I think generally, Sarah, you asked if we were comfortable with the numbers. I think I would echo Trustee Padilla's sentiments that I don't feel qualified to make that assessment. I think it's just really important that we do a couple things. One, we preserve the very strong narrative that the board and staff has done an excellent job the past few years in helping the development community understand that development in Frederick is a privilege. And in order to develop in Frederick, you pay your own way. And we'll do everything we can to help you be successful as a developer. But at the end of the day, you pay your own way. And that's all there is to it. So whatever language comes out of this plan, process, improvement fee changes, I think that needs to be very strongly echoed in there.
the other piece to that is tying in the conservation piece. I mean, I think communicating this change to the public, to the community, to our current residents, I think we need to put a little bit more due diligence to how it connects to conservation in general. So, because the perception is going to be, we just made it a heck of a lot easier for developers to bring residential dwelling units to the town of Frederick. So we need to be very clear that this is a conservation effort, and it's more reasonable and fair and balanced to the development community, yes, but it is not an incentive package, and it's not a call for development in the town of Frederick. So I think that communication needs to be very clear to the community.
In regards to timeline, as far, you know, we currently have it slated to have this in ordinance form next month. Would you prefer that to come at a little bit of a later date so that we can do more of that outreach or concurrent or?
More time. Perhaps the summer?
Yes.
And Mayor, I would also suggest, too, as part of our community tour and talks, part of that, I think maybe we can even have a presence with the water efficiency plan. But I know on Sarah's last slide where it was an example of a commercial lot, and you mentioned there's a lot of turf in there. That's part of what we're going through, too, with our land use code update. We get complaints about businesses that have been put in the past, and our land use code allows or requires them to put in so much turf, and we get complaints from residents of why are we requiring this if water is such a problem or a shortage. And so I think that's part of this communication effort too, is to ensure that if that is available for the public, it's for a specific use, but we're not going to require that of businesses anymore either, because it is wasting water. So absolutely.
Well, and keep in mind, this comment's probably decently sensitive, and I don't mean any disrespect by it, but for several years, this community has heard from its government, its elected officials, and otherwise, that we have a water problem and that we very soon could run out of water, and that's not true. And we're fulfilling our obligations for, you know, all subdivisions, and every resident will have ample amount of water to take a bath and water their plants. But that's what they've heard for several years. So we can't in good conscience all of a sudden turn around and say, we have enough water. In fact, we're going to charge you a little bit less for the water, right? It just doesn't, it's not going to resonate with this community because they were fed half-truths. So we need to fix that.
I think to your point, what this does is it incentivizes people to look at lower water use intensities, especially in that outdoor space where there's more or less, not a credit, but a less of a requirement. If you're going to do the things that require less water, we're going to work with you. Because otherwise, you know, as a business or developer, otherwise, why would I put in something more Xeric or Colorado native and have to pay for all the water anyways? It doesn't make sense. So this provides that incentive without putting the town at risk.
Right.
Subsidize it.
Yeah, you get what you incentivize, and this incentive looks a little bit different, but yeah I agree. I'm very supportive of moving forward with this. How do you all feel about it?
Yes. Forward?
Sounds like maybe a little bit more time to configure the communication strategy to our current residents and to the development community. Can we meet again mid to end of summer? Is that an applicable amount of time to talk about what the rollout strategy will look like for this and for the code changes? Yes?
Yep.
I feel like that's not okay. I can't,
no, it's fine.
I can't quite tell.
Well,
good.
Okay.
I've got a
yeah, I'm just trying to think of
a question. So it's not so much when we vote on it, there's a minimum allowance of 30 days, correct, before it can become?
After publication.
After publication, but we, from my understanding, we have more time before we have to, so we can say 60 days or 90 days.
Correct.
So is there any reason, if we're comfortable on all this, to not move with June 13th, but then to extend the time that we actually put it into effect?
Mm-hmm.
Because it sounds like all the work is done, and this is the direction we could potentially go. So why not just go ahead and vote for it if it's ready on the 13th, and then use that however many days we need to educate and inform the public that these are the changes coming, if the writing's on the wall that this is most likely the way that this is going to happen.
Yeah, you're right. That could be confusing to a resident. You know, they would probably say, if we're talking about it at a tour and talk or an event, like, is this, are you voting on this? Can I change your mind? Or has this happened and now you're educating me on what's happened and how it's happened? Those are two different things. So you're right. So what's your preference?
I would put forth that if it's going to be ready to be presented on the 13th, that we do so. And then with that presentation, determine the date of effectiveness.
Okay.
To allow public education and information should that ordinance pass or this
60 to 90 days.
60, just I threw out numbers, but whatever the board's comfortable with to give time to educate versus here's what's potentially going to happen. Because you're right, we're opening, so we could influence this and change this and massively rewrite everything. Whereas it sounds like this is the final product that is going to be brought forth to vote.
Mm-hmm. Here's what I need to prepare for.
I do too. And so what I can do in drafting the ordinance is just kind of leave a placeholder for when its effective date will be. And that'll give you an opportunity as a board between now and June 13th to kind of come up with your thoughts as to what that would be. And then at that board meeting, when we pass the resolution or the ordinance, you just tell me what date you want to put in there and we can make that change before it gets published.
It works for me.
Sound good, Chad? Sounds good.
Yep, thumbs up.
Okay. Sarah, how do you feel about that plan? Good? Good? Okay. All right, we'll see you on the 13th then.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Sarah.
Thank you. Super. Appreciate all that work, Sarah. Thank you. And Jason. Okay, trustee reports or any other, we don't have any other discussion items, but if you have trustee reports that are lengthy, we can turn them into a discussion item if you'd like. Anyone?
I got something since I see Kevin sitting back there and also Kent sitting back there. I don't know why, but the last couple of 3 days, maybe a little longer than that, I've had these people come to me about the condition of Highway 52 and who can they complain to about addressing the condition of Highway 52 from basically just east of I-25 all the way down to Colorado Boulevard. And I quite frankly, I would assume it's the state, but is that right to tell them they could go to CDOT?
Is there a specific contact we could give them that would help to speed up our process in getting that addressed?
Yeah, there's one section that's
Yeah, I know. We've had lots of complaints about this, the potholes.
Yeah, and we do have contacts, so we can definitely share that with the board, so you can share it with your constituents that are reaching out to you, and that'll be part of the operations group, so they'll be able to document it right away and know the people, the crews that can go out and take care of it. I have reached out to the CDOT Region 4 director, and she did get back with me and mentioned that in July, there's a couple of work sessions that she would be and her team would be able to come see the Frederick board and give a little talk about what's happening with 52 and kind of listen to your feedback and give you a channel to talk to her directly about what you're hearing and what maybe you want to see them do in the future. So,
right.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Brave.
I'd be pitchforks and torches out there.
Right. That's the thing though. There's a difference. I think, you know, in general, CDOT thinks that we always want to talk about growth strategy for Highway 52. We do, of course. But that's what you all do, and you do very well as staff. You talk about, you know, access control plans. You talk about traffic congestion. You talk about all that. We just want to live in Frederick, and we just want to drive to and from places and not fall into a pothole. So it would be great if your contacts in that conversation understand there's a time and place to talk about development and growth. Right now, we just want to talk about fixing what's already there.
Okay.
That would be great.
I can communicate that clearly, and I think it was the couple of work session dates in July that they said they were available. So.
Okay.
Just so long as I've got a good, valid contact to give to these people, because they're tired of me telling them, I think it's CDOT.
Yeah. Right. I'll give you the person and the phone number, and you can forward that. So.
I need. Thank you.
Okay.
I think we'll get a schedule. I think the 11th of July. Yeah. We'll have it.
I say, we talked about canceling work sessions in the summer. So.
Yes. Okay. So it's a pre-meeting.
Pre-meeting. Got it. Okay. Great. Okay. Kevin?
Thanks. Thanks, Kev.
Good point. Some communities, I think I mentioned this last time, have made a joke about the potholes, and people have planted flowers in their potholes. And I find that funny.
Yes.
Did she see that? Is that who told me?
Yes, and she has a friend that actually did do that.
Plant flowers?
Yes. They planted a tree.
A tree. I mean, that's how you get someone to pay attention to the...
I wouldn't recommend
that. Made the news a while back.
No, yeah, it won't last very long. Little baby group, maybe. Any other items?
I think Trustee Tivaldi has his hand up.
Oh, great.
Yes.
So I was having dinner and ended up chatting for quite a while with a couple of Frederick residents that worked for the town of Firestone. And they expressed disappointment that they could not figure out a way to have the 4th of July parade go through Frederick again due to, I don't know, like no response from Frederick, or the staff wasn't very communicative, or somebody said it, they couldn't do it. I'm not accusing of anything. I just wanted to hear maybe what's going on there or what happened there. That it's kind of an historic thing. I've been to it a few times in Frederick. And just wondered what happened this year, why it's not going to do that.
Well, that's a good point, Trustee Tivaldi and Mayor. We'll reach out to Firestone. I know we just talked to them today and yesterday. There have been
comments. I think some of the information we received that just logistically, they didn't feel like it could come down here anymore because of the timing. But I know the last couple of years, and we've made it clear with the team that we won't be charging any type of, and we haven't in the past, a fee for them, an application. We work together as partnerships, and so I don't know. We'll find out. We'll reach out to them, and that's good feedback.
Okay. I'd hate to see it be that how come it didn't go through Frederick, and the answer is, well, Frederick wouldn't let us do it. You know, I hate hearing that. So, I mean, it doesn't mean that that's true. It just means that that's what I heard. So,
yeah.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah, I did see a post on that earlier today from, I think, the volunteer coordinator of it, of the 4th at Firestone. And she was very transparent and said that their efforts this year were to focus on what they're planning for their new downtown. They're building a potential new downtown, and they wanted the parade to go around this proposed downtown. So it has nothing to do with, and she's not publicizing that Frederick has said no and that we're not willing to participate. It's that they wanted their event to center around their town, and they're trying to build a historic downtown. So that was their focus. So maybe we go back and take a look at her communication, because she's the volunteer coordinator on that event. So freaking Firestone.
I was going to volunteer.
We I was going to say, I know a road that we
can let them line up on ours. Yeah,
I mean, can we use the concrete barriers in this parade at some point?
If you're interested in a float.
Are you kidding me?
Can we do a float?
We can do a float.
My goodness. I mean, you can't get more.
Can we get t-shirts for that float? That
ironic than this.
Well, just somebody come up with the idea of having those retaining walls on your t-shirt. Right.
Ours will say, we're the fun side of the wall.
There you go. I like it.
There you go. There you go. I like that.
That's funny. Thank you, Chad. Right?
Adam.
Do you all have any trustee reports?
I don't think so.
Nothing constructive.
Nothing constructive. Okay. Couple just really quick things. That actually the parade was on my list as well, but really just wanted to and Renee, I apologize about putting you on the spot, but you know, could I entertain a conversation between your team and the board and talk about can we use 2023-2024 as an opportunity to introduce a new event to the town of Frederick. We get a lot of compliments on our events every year. We get a lot of attendance. They grow and grow and grow, which is fantastic. But last year we talked about, you know, what's something new we can bring to the community, and would we bring it in the winter? Would we bring it, would it be complementary to another town's events? And maybe at some point we look at and say the 4th at Firestone, they are separating and moving to Firestone. So is there something in Frederick we can do that's complementary to the hall? I don't know, but I think every few years we should have that conversation of what's something new that we can bring to our community to celebrate together and gather. So I would like to hear from your perspective. I know your team worked on it a couple years ago. They brought a couple of ideas, such as like a singing bee. We heard about a carnival. We heard about a couple of other things, but would be nice to hear some new event opportunities, I think, eventually. On that note, Frederick and Flight is in June. And then I would like to ask the board if we talked about last meeting about the infrastructure tax conversation, about the board having a tent at Frederick and Flight and being available to answer questions and get feedback from the community on potential infrastructure tax. If that's your prerogative, I would appreciate it. I know the communication team has already said we have access to a tent and a space. I would just need to send out, you know, a sign-up genius to all of you and ask that you take, you know, 2-hour shift or so during Frederick and Flight, and we coordinate it to where there's at least a trustee or two available to answer public's questions and communicate throughout the event.
What date is Frederick and Flight? I can't remember off the top of my
head. We were just talking about this.
June 20. What did I write it down? Where did I write it?
Right before CML.
23rd through the 25th.
We'll be out of town. I would, if I were here, I would gladly support and do my time, but I will be out of town, so I can't offer any opinion on that.
Okay. So Well, I'll send it out, and there'll be just blocks of time, and then that way, you know, I'll provide the handouts and waters and all those things. So don't just show up and open the dialogue with our community on infrastructure. Anything, obviously, if they have questions for you, I think that'd be helpful. So look for that in the next few days. No?
Only infrastructure.
You only want to talk about infrastructure. Okay. That's fair. You do that. We mentioned just briefly today, and we mentioned last week, there was a few trustees that were absent from our meeting last week that we talked about canceling the every other Tuesday work sessions and blending them into our regularly scheduled board meetings on the 2nd and 4th Tuesday of the month. So if we have items that need to be addressed in a work session fashion, you will see them before the board meeting. So you potentially could have a few Tuesdays in the summer that have an earlier start time, but we'll make sure that you have ample notice of that. But just know that way you can plan time with your families and enjoy, since we have barbecues and all those things with the community, we'll try to simplify that. And then, Brian, you said you'll cover some updates on ICSC. Things like that. We haven't had an economic development update in a while. So is that plan? Are we planning on that on the strategic plan update on June 6th? That is a work session. Mm-hmm. It's still planned.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes. Okay. We will plan on that, as well as at the next regular meeting, we'll have an update on ICSC, as well as we also have the, I don't remember the date, but we have a business roundtable coming up as well.
On the 14th of June.
Yes. And as part of that, we'll also talk about, we've got some information on telephone town halls of things we can incorporate that. So we'll utilize that June 6th opportunity to talk about scheduling that as well.
Okay, thank you. I might meet with yourself, and if you have team members like telephone town hall, may I meet with Renee on that? Okay, I will not be available at that June 6th work session, so. Okay, thank you. And then can we just share that there is a Memorial Day celebration? Do you have the details on that with you? Adam will be speaking at the Memorial Day celebration on Friday. I believe it's at 4:00. Yes?
4 to 7, tentatively, I believe.
It's Park.
Park. Yep. So if you're available, would like to celebrate Memorial Day together, that's where we'll be.
Speaking or singing or both?
Speaking.
Oh, that would be a treat.
You want to see me sing? You got to go to the Colorado Freedom Memorial the next day.
Oh. I feel like we should get preferential treatment, but.
Yeah, of course not.
Exciting. Okay. Any other items? No? Anything from staff?
All right, I will then, or now, like to recommend that we go into executive session for the purpose of determining positions relative to matters that may be subject to negotiations, developing strategy for negotiations, and or instructing negotiators under CRS section 24-6-402-4E1 regarding property acquisition.
So moved.
Second.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Lamock?
Yes.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Great, thank you. Let's take a 5-minute recess.